Welcome to the A-Game Podcast with Nick Lamagna, digging into the minds and experiences of some of today's brightest entrepreneurs in real estate and business, along with Hollywood stars, UFC fighters, and your favorite rock bands. People that have figured out how to overcome obstacles, take chances, live boldly, and no matter what they do, they always bring their A-Game.
My guest today on the A-Game Podcast is Matt Larson. Matt's a guy I have been following for a very long time. I'm sure when you see him or you hear his name, you're going to say, oh, yeah, that's right. I've been connected with that guy forever. So he's an OG in the game. He's been doing high-level real estate for over 18 years, owned over 400 properties, done thousands and thousands and thousands of transactions, and he's gotten to the point where he can have a multi-million dollar business, and he's literally putting in like less than 30 minutes a week at this point to do that. So if you are a beginner, an advanced, an intermediate, an aspiring investor, basically anybody all shapes and sizes, we talk how to get started, how to expand, how to manage your VAs, how to find your VAs, how to be a good leader, what's going on in the market now, what kind of changes are coming, how he identified some of the best buying opportunities of a lifetime twice now. So definitely a guy you want to be following. Definitely check the show notes for all the ways to link up with him. And I think everybody's really going to enjoy this podcast. He also helps you guys do this stuff. Obviously, he's got systems and processes and people he's put in place that he can benefit from the experience and he can teach you guys how to do, or he helps place them as well. So a lot of really good synergies just from the information to the education to the implementation to all kinds of great stuff. So I had a great time talking to Matt Larson. It was way overdue. I've been wanting to have him on for a very long time. Awesome guy. Great conversation. I think you guys will love it. So while you're checking the show notes for all the ways to connect with him, do not forget to go to nicknicknick.com/links. L-I-N-K-S, and find all the ways to subscribe to this podcast. It is the only fee. We're creeping on 300 episodes now of people that are amazing guests that I'm blown away every day they agree to come on. The way we keep this going is, please, if you have not, take 30 seconds, jump on any of the places you watch your podcast, or just go on nicknicknick.com/links, and you can click on Spotify, you can click on YouTube, you can click on Apple Podcasts, or wherever you listen to your podcast, hit the follow or the subscribe button. It makes a big difference. And also, you'll see us on social media. When I post clips of this episode with Matt, if you're not following us, please follow us. Instagram's very, we're very active on that, but we're active on all social platforms. Let Matt know you appreciate what he's sharing by liking the comments, sharing the comments, sharing the clips, communicating in the clips, tagging a friend. Like, that 2 seconds goes a long way for the algorithms, and that is how we keep that party going. And of course, the big thing here is I want to do real estate together, especially here in 2024. Let's take this to the next level. Let's do some deals together. Buy properties from me, sell properties to me, or let's have a conversation of how we can partner up together in any way, shape, or form. The way to do that is either message me directly on social media, the words real estate, and then my assistant will know to send it to me, or text me the words real estate directly, 516-540-5733. 516-540-5733. And last but not least, for a free checklist on how to bring more values to your buyers as a real estate agent or wholesaler, go to nicknicknick.com/biggerpockets. So I appreciate you guys. I appreciate Matt. A-Game Podcast 2024. Let's have an amazing Q1. Let's do some deals. Because if you listen to this, as he's saying, huge opportunity to pick them up now, and then even better opportunity because they're probably going to increase in value as the rates drop. So let's get some deals done. Let's make some money. Let's not like look back and regret and wish we did more. Have a great day. Thank you, everybody. A-Game Podcast. All right, my guest today is an entrepreneur and educator who went from working in a shop in Illinois that was almost 300 square feet to a professional real estate investor doing over 4,000 transactions worth over $85 million in value. He has done it all from fix and flips to owning 400 rentals and countless transactions wholesaling. He's looking to truly create the four-hour work week, and he began creating systems and processes. He's using virtual assistants that he runs a multi-million dollar business through his black belt in hiring and training VAs overseas. He now helps investors just like you utilize his systems through his people, his processes, and his multiple platforms, including Rapid Assistance and the Deal Lab. And he has some huge feathers in his cap for entrepreneurs he's helped, including Dean Grazioso, and also personally trained the one and only Tony Robbins, a gentleman that I have been watching for a very long time, way overdue to have him on the podcast. Big fan, sir. Thank you for being here today. Welcome to the A-Game Podcast, Matt Larson.
It's good to be here. Glad to hopefully add some value.
You definitely will, sir. And of course, as I just learned, also a fellow dog lover, so we'll definitely go through that. So if somebody's been living under a rock and they're not sure 100% who Matt Larson is, can you give like a 30,000-foot view of who you are and where you came from?
Yeah, I'm Matt Larson. I grew up in Illinois. My main operation is in Iowa. I'm at my lake house right now in Illinois, where I spend most of my time. I've been in real estate 18 years, done over 4,000 deals, pretty much done everything from own a lot of rental properties to tons and tons of wholesaling, lots and lots of fix and flips, and pretty much anything in between. But, as I've gotten older, I'm now 48, I've transitioned from wanting to be, take over the world, which I'm still very, very aggressive and have high goals, but I'm more of a lifestyle type guy now. I think as you get older, you realize, your time is limited, and you can spend your lifetime working. And I think work is good, but I also don't want to, I don't want to live to work, So yeah, I've just focused in the last few years more on the lifestyle side of things.
I think that's awesome, man. I feel like I very much had that expectation I was going into. I always told everybody, quality of life guy, like if I could figure out how to make the same amount of money through real estate that I would have made as a police officer in New York City, I don't have to get shot at. I could sit home and play with my dogs all day. I felt like it was a win. And obviously your goals and your expectations grow from there. But I think part of what I'm very interested in with you is you saw an infomercial first, which again, I'm closer to your age. We're kind of showing our ages here, but the infomercials, that was the thing that grabbed a lot of us. And I can't tell you how many people, I'm sure you come across them too, that when you talk to them about real estate, their answer is like, oh man, like years ago, I bought the Carlton Sheets book. Like I saw the infomercial for Robert Allen. Like it was the old school names and everybody has the box, but I'm always blown away when there's that like one in 100 person who's like, dude, I bought the Carlton Sheets book and I made like 15 grand on that thing. And I'm like, holy crap, dude. Like if you could do that, like then you could do that now, but most people buy the box and they don't do anything with it. So what was in you that you actually took the action and made money with the stuff you learned from the initial infomercial?
Yeah. And here's the other thing too, is like some of us older guys, the infomercial things that was around before social media was. And now the infomercial things kind of faded because social media has taken over. But no, I think everybody has a why. Everybody has a reason why they take maybe crazy risks or do crazy new habits that kind of propel them to another level. For me, I got out of high school and went to college for one semester. After that one semester, they told me I couldn't come back. And so I went to work in a local machine shop in a small town in Illinois where I grew up. So at 19 years old, I'm working in a machine shop. And, it's not really the goals that I had in life when I was in high school. We always have these crazy, I'm going to be a professional football player or whatever it is. And so all of a sudden I found myself in a machine shop and, it's not that I hated it. I didn't really like the environment. I didn't mind the work, but I start working in a machine shop and years can clip by really, really fast. And at 26 years old, I'd been in, working in that environment for, several years and it went by really fast. And I started dating this girl at 26. She was a little bit older than me, was a doctor. She actually had her doctorate. And so here's some guy that's, working in a machine shop, coming home every day, just covered in grease and, 12-hour shifts and no air conditioning and no windows and like, probably didn't smell the best. And, here I am dating somebody that's probably way out, well, definitely out of my financial, range, but also just her job style. But we dated for about 4 years. And at the end of, by the time I was 30, we'd been dating for 4 years, and she came up to me one day and just said, "Hey, I want to break up." And when I asked her why, she said, "Because I want to date somebody with status, somebody that makes money." And I think before that time period, I never really understood how money was made. I always grew up with my dad telling me, my dad's just an old school, hardworking guy. And he never had, he was never an entrepreneur and he worked, for somebody his whole life. And I never really had anybody show me about making money. So here I was 30 years old, heartbroken because, somebody, my girlfriend at the time wanted to date somebody with status, somebody that made money. And I'm now trying to figure out how to make money. And I had never heard of the self-help section of a library or of a bookstore. I had never read a self-help book. I didn't even know it existed. And all of a sudden, I have a compelling reason to try to figure out how to make money. So I lived in this 300 square foot apartment, and the TV room is also the bedroom. Like, it was very, very small. And back then, I would just leave the TV on all night. Something that I would never do now and haven't done for years. But back then, that was like my background noise. So I woke up one night and the TV's on, couldn't sleep, stressed out. And this infomercial came on. And, you know, it had this young looking guy. And I had seen the Carlton Sheets thing, you know, infomercials and the Robert Allen, but I never took action on it. I don't know if it's because I thought those are just really rich old dudes. But this young guy comes on here and he's showing all these houses that he's flipping. I made $42,000 on this one, $37,000 on this one, and you can do it with no money. And, you know, the book was like $37 with, you know, rapid delivery. And I took the chance on it, and I thought, you know, maybe this is my chance. And I got the book, and I just couldn't put it down. There were several little books in there, and I read them over and over and over again. And I really felt like that was my thing. And I think because I had never tried any money-making things before in my life and, you know, hadn't read any books like that before, I was naive enough to think that it was just totally true. And luckily, a lot of success comes from your belief. And I just believed that everything I read I could do, and then it would work. And so in 30 days, I did my very first deal. And then I did 12 deals my first year, following what I learned in the book. And I took some advanced coaching as well along that path. And so this is in 2005, and the market was very, very hot back then, very, very competitive, similar to what it is now, probably worse, because back then you didn't have to have cash. You could just go to the bank. I didn't know how to do this part, and I wouldn't have done it because, you can get in a lot of trouble for doing this. But people were going to the bank saying, hey, I make $500,000 a year. Give me a line of credit. And they were getting it because there was no docs, there was no research done whether or not it was just a stated income. And so you were competing against a lot of people that had access to unlimited money, which is why a lot of the downturn happened. And I did that for 3 years, and I got really, really good at, marketing and getting leads and making offers to sellers. And I got good at negotiating, and because it was a competitive market. And then 2008 hit. I have 3 years now under my belt, and the market crashes, and I'm like, I'm ready at this point. I left my job in November of 2008, which most people thought was crazy back then, because that was at a time when there was lots and lots of layoffs every month. That's all you heard about in the news, and most people were kind of clinging to job security. And I'm calling my boss saying, I want today to be my last day. And so I used those 3 years of very difficult, very hard to get deals, but I did it, and I honed my skills. So when 08 hit, the next 4 or 5 years were unbelievable. I went in 2008, I had about 30 houses in my portfolio. And by 2013, I had 450 properties in my portfolio, not doors, talking properties, talking houses, duplexes, fourplexes, apartment buildings. And I didn't do syndicated stuff. Most of that stuff I owned by myself. There was a portion of that I owned 50-50, but none of it I owned less than 50%. And on top of that, I was wholesaling a lot. I made a lot of money during that whole downturn. And so I was making massive amounts of cash. I was piling money into my savings account, but at the same time, my income was seven figures. My savings account was seven figures, and I had a massive portfolio of houses. So my net worth was very strong too, with 450 properties. And I bought all that stuff at a really big discount. So I was one of the people that did really well during the downturn and capitalized on it. And so from there, that's 2013 is 10 years ago now. And I continued to buy all the way through around 2020. I stopped buying. I knew we were towards the peak. COVID hit. I made one last push when COVID, if you remember during COVID, the first couple of months after COVID, 2-3 months, the market really dropped hard. And then it rebounded during that drop. And I posted this on social media back then. I have all of the old posts. I said, hey, you're going to have a small dip. Go buy as many houses as you can. When it recovers, you can sell them. I bought 80 houses in a very short window of time and spent the next couple of years selling those off. So yeah, I mean, that's pretty much the kind of the run that I've been on now. 2021, we peaked, in my opinion, and it's dropped since then. And we're still, it's still a competitive market in the sense that there's not a lot of inventory on the market, but there's also not a lot of buyers. So now I'm doing a lot of wholesaling. Wholesaling is my primary exit strategy right now. I'm not really adding to my portfolio at all. And then, and I'm doing a few fix and flips a month, but that's pretty much it. I mean, the whole goal of real estate is to buy low and sell high. And that's kind of what I did over the last cycles.
Man, I think that's so incredible. And listening to you talk about transitioning right into the next thing I was going to ask about, because you and David Green are two guys that I saw really capitalize on that quick dip and that huge boost that we had in that like 18 to 24 month cycle, where I tell everybody usually a market cycle like that is people buy stuff in like 2008 and then you wait 10, 12 years for it to go back up. And people saw a decade worth of real estate appreciation and dips in 18 months and became millionaires. Mm-hmm. Like, it was crazy. And I don't know if you know Tim Kalis, but Tim Kalis was on the podcast and he phrased it very well. He said, there's opportunity in volatility. And I think when you look back at what you did acquiring all those assets during the 2008 crash and then recognizing the same thing with COVID, it goes back to the whole Warren Buffett of like buy when people are scared and sell when people are greedy. And you recognize those opportunities. What are some, like, what was the difference there? What was going on in your brain that you were able to recognize that that's the time to buy and then recognize the time to sell?
Because everybody was afraid. You know, I just saw fear in the marketplace. And I don't want people to think that, I don't want people to think that I'm like not ever scared. I make moves a lot of times when I even doubt myself a little bit. But, I think that's courage when you act in spite of fear. I'm pretty careful nowadays because there's a lot of guys that get wiped out because they make some, they spend a lifetime of gaining wealth and they make a few bad decisions. And we're going to see a lot of that in the next few years. And so I don't want people to think that I'm never afraid or I'm always 100% confident, because that's not accurate. We all have a little bit of self-doubt in there, but I see an opportunity. I use my 4,000 plus deals experience that I have. I have a really, really solid team. You know, that's another big piece to this whole thing. The longer you're in business and the more that you have people that have been with you for a long time, it helps you execute on plans that you put together. Whereas if you're by yourself or with a new team, it's a little harder to do. So in 2008, it was easy to see. There was a lot of blood in the streets, a lot of people going through foreclosures, banks struggling, businesses struggling. And those are the opportunities that an entrepreneur looks for. I remember calling a buddy of mine. I was getting ready to call my boss and tell him I was putting in my notice, or I wanted today to be my last day. And I called a buddy of mine right before I did that. And he's like, because I was self-doubting myself, like, man, is this really a good idea? And he's like, you got to do it, man. You got to do it. You're ready. So I did it. And of course, that worked out really, really well, because I did a lot of deals before I quit my job. And when I quit my job in 2008 and I could spend all my time in real estate, it was like on steroids. And when COVID hit, same thing. If you remember right, the stock market plummeted during that initial phase of COVID. And you just have to shake somebody's confidence about 5 or 10%. And that's all it takes to come in and swoop in and make moves and make money. And that's what COVID did. But I also knew we were in the greatest uprising of real estate that I had probably ever been able to go through. So I didn't think it would last. And so, and that's why I told everybody to kind of make moves and buy houses really cheap. And we made a ton of offers, and I even shot my marketing off and just focused on the leads we already had in our system. And it was that easy to lock down deals.
That's so smart, man. There's so many different directions we can go in there. We're just controlling fear and like leads in your system versus like paying for new leads. But obviously all that is just more effort. And I'm very interested in hearing about how did that transition from you doing all these deals and making all this money to being able to see the light at the end of the tunnel with utilizing virtual assistants to be able to have the same amount of efficiency, profit, but not have to put in all that time.
Mm-hmm. So in 2017, I flipped, that year I flipped, it was around 350, 400 houses ish, something 355, 360, something in that range. That's a lot of houses. You know, if you do the math on per houses per month, that's a lot of houses. And I made, I did 34 million in top line sales that year. And, but I only put 1.8 million in my pocket. And for those people listening right now, some people might say, well, making 1.8 million net is really good. It's not really good when your top line number is 34 million. So I realized at that point that my overhead had grown, and I had to flip nine to 10 houses a month just to break even. That's a lot of pressure. And so I realized that I was making more money doing fewer deals with a smaller team in previous years. And so what I did was I thought, okay, I had been dabbling with virtual assistants since 2015. So I was 2 years into really working with virtual assistants, but I hadn't made it a widespread process across my companies. So I got my main management team together, and I just said, hey, you know, we made money this year, but we didn't make a good, our profit percentage was not very good. So we're going to make some changes. Every time somebody on our staff, and I had 50 people in my office at that time, every time somebody quits or gets fired, we're going to replace them with a VA. And we did that. We executed on that plan. And it took about 3 years to completely evolve all of the positions, but it saved over $1 million a year in my overhead and payroll. And so now I don't have to do hardly any deals, and it pays for the overhead. And so that's really when the light went off. It's like, okay, when I started hiring VAs that I was paying $6-$8 an hour to, that were replacing somebody, an American that I was paying $60,000 a year for, and I was getting a better result. So it wasn't like, okay, I'm hiring this VA, they're making $8 an hour, this American's making $65,000 a year. It's not quite as good, but it wasn't like that at all. I got a better output. I got a better employee in the VA than I did the American. VAs don't use discretion. They operate off of the process that you give them. Americans use discretion. What I mean by that is when you give American a task, they say, I'm smarter than Matt. I've got a better way. I'm going to do it this way over here. And then that disrupts the process. And discretion is the enemy of duplication. So with what I realized is that Americans tried to figure out better ways all the time, and they wouldn't follow systems. And that caused breaks in the chain. So the VAs wouldn't do that. They just did the job the way they were taught to do. They followed the written and video processes we created, and it worked flawlessly. And so I just pushed really hard over the last few years to make my whole company 100% virtual, which now we operate 100% virtual. And in 2021, early in 2021, I started my own education business because when you have a business that operates without you, you end up not having stuff to do. And in 2020, I was basically laying on the couch, eating a lot of food, gaining weight. And a mentor of mine said, Matt, you ought to start an education business. And because I'd been paid royalties for 8 years to create other gurus' education plans, and that was awesome. But that had come to an end, and this one mentor said, you know, if you create your own education, you'll make a lot of money doing that probably. And I just said, man, I just don't think anybody will buy my stuff. And so I gave it a try because I didn't have anything else going on anyway. So by February of 2020, I had started my own education business. We ended up doing over $1 million in sales that year at 89% profit, $1,058,000 in sales, but an 89% profit margin. My CFO was like, he's an older guy who's been around for a long time. And he's just like, I've never seen a business with that high a profit margin. So the education business is a very profitable business if it's done right. But what happened was I was selling my main education. I was selling was all e-products, e-books. And the main one that I was selling the most of was my virtual assistant systems and processes. So we had a full program. We still have this, whereas I took all of the systems and processes we used in my business from running my VAs, packaged them up into its own program and offered them for sale. And it did amazing. And one day somebody called me and said, hey, Matt, I bought your virtual unemployed program. It's the best program I've ever bought. Thing is, I don't want to do any of the work. Can I just hire one of your VAs? So I didn't offer my VAs to anybody prior to that phone call. I went back to my team and just said, hey, you know, people are asking for, if we can find and hire their VAs for them and hand them off, and then they don't have to do any of it. We decided to give it a try. It ended up working. And that business, I just couldn't, it's been the craziest, insane trajectory of any business I've ever owned. And it went nuts. We did really well with it. We still do it. We probably place 20 VAs a week right now. And across the country, we have a lot of seven-figure wholesalers that have my VAs. And so that business was created out of as almost a byproduct of the education business. And so now we train. We not only are 100% virtual and do all our deals without Americans and use virtual assistants, to now we place VAs with other investors that do the same. It's been pretty wild.
If you have been kicking yourself that you didn't start investing in real estate sooner, whether you're beginner, intermediate, or advanced, any way you're looking to get in on a residential, commercial, land development, wholesaling, fix and flips, whatever it is, let's find a way to get you involved in some projects, get you some properties, whether you want to sell some properties to me, whether you want to buy some properties from me, whether residential, fix and flip, cash flow, multifamily, whatever it is you're looking for, let's figure out a way to get you involved or find a way for us to partner up on some deals. Go to www.nicknicknick.com, go on the consultation tab and figure out how to schedule an appointment to talk about where you fit in if you are not sure, or you can just reach out to me on any of my social media channels. If you go on www.nicknicknick.com/links, you will see all the different ways to connect with me and figure out how we can start to work together, make it happen. Everybody that invests in real estate always just says they wish they did it sooner. Best time to start is today.
That's incredible, man. You and I definitely need to talk offline about that as well. And I have bought some of your products already. I was saying earlier, you're a marketing master, man, because you've been popping up in my email funnels for quite some time. And I'm like, all right, it's time. I'm going to grab this. I'm going to grab that. So it is working, sir. You're doing a great job. But when we talk about VAs here, there's a few like key things that I'd love to have just discussion points or just quick questions on. You said a lot of yours are overseas. And I go back and forth sometimes when I talk to people or when I'm looking at my own business of, is it like a benefit to have them speaking really good English versus somebody who doesn't? Or are you still finding like that there's plenty of people that speak really good English even though they're overseas?
Oh, yeah. No, good English is super important. It's one of the things that we screen right away. We actually give every VA an English test. One of the reasons that I don't want people to think that if you just go hire a VA, you'll be successful. That's not how that works. There's a lot of VAs out there, and most of them will not be a good fit in your organization. They're not good. They're not well-trained. They don't know what they're doing. And just because the word VA, a lot of people think that I just need to hire a VA and I'll just start making money. I thought that when I got my first one too. And so the thing is, it's not the VA that's the magic in our system. It's the training and the screening that we go through with them that sifts and sorts and screens out all of the VAs that are not amazing. So the actual stat is only 5.5% of the VAs that come through our system, screening and training, ever get placed with a client. And that's the magic. So in other words, for every 100 VAs that we run through our program, only 5.5 get placed. Nobody does it that way. And the reason they don't is because it's too expensive. But for us, if you're looking for an average, you know, VA that's, you know, not that good, we're not the people to see. If you want the Rolls Royce of VAs and you want to do a lot of deals, that's us. So we're not the cheapest by far, but cheap doesn't get deals done. Good quality and high level skill, that's what gets deals done. So that's kind of what we focused on from the get-go, is I don't want to be the biggest VA company. I just want to have the best VAs on the planet.
I love that, man. And for, like, obviously a lot of real estate investors you're dealing with, a lot of real estate investors listening to this podcast, what are some of, like, the top tasks or roles that you have right now that your VAs are getting trained for, or you're outsourcing to other investors?
Pretty much every position we do, texting, cold calling. The thing that really brought me to the next level was when we released our virtual closers, our acquisitions VAs, and they negotiate and, you know, they negotiate with the sellers and lock up the deals at a discount. They're all trained personally by me every week. And we actually have a very sophisticated training program they go through for sales training. But so acquisitions VAs, dispositions VAs to sell the deal, lead managers to run the whole operation, follow-up VAs. I mean, you name it, executive assistants, you name it. We have VAs for it. And I didn't plan on having, you know, 15 different VA types in the beginning, but our customers came to us and said, "Hey, I just got your acquisitions VAs, and now I have a problem. I'm stacking up contracts, but I don't have the time to dispo them. Can you come up with a dispositions VA?" And that wherever their bottleneck moved, they came back to us and just said, "Can you create this VA for us?" And then that's kind of where we headed next.
That's awesome, man. I love all this stuff. Now, I understand the sample task. Like, to me, that's huge, is coming up with some sample tasks for them to fit whatever that role is. And I was going to ask about what some of them are, but I guess it's too broad a question, because it depends on what you're hiring them for, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, it's like anything else. You know, every single VA has, so we don't use third party anything. We have our own HR, we have our own screening processes. We created all of the education is stuff that we created ourselves. All the training they take, the classroom, the live training, that's all stuff that we created just through our own experience of doing a lot of deals in our own business. So my actual wholesale team is the team that started the whole training process for VAs that we place with other people.
That's awesome, man. And when you talk about, like, from the cold calling side of it, I think this is probably, in my experience, like the first, like the gateway drug to VAs, is you start with a cold caller and then you outsource some of these other things. But I get asked a lot about incentives, like, especially from my team. They're like, "Hey, man, what about, like, if you close a deal, do you incentivize me? Do I get paid time off? Do I get paid for vacations?" How do you handle that, like, with that initial hire for a VA? Are you incentivizing cold callers for deals closed from your disposition? Whatever the next role is.
Yeah. So our cold callers don't get a bonus for leads that they bring in or anything like that. We just pay them really well. But the acquisitions VAs, the lead managers, and the disposition VAs all get paid a bonus when a deal closes. So they're paid a high hourly wage, but they also get additional bonuses for closed deals. Not contracts, like the deal actually has to close. But yeah, I mean, I believe that... you know, here's the thing with VAs. If you treat them well and you pay them well, they're like the 1950s Americans. They want to be with your companies forever. You know, they don't want to job hop and move to the next company. They want to stay put. They want to feel like they're part of the team, and they'll stay and work hard for you. Again, if you do a good job in the beginning of screening for the right ones, they'll work hard for you, and they just want to stay with you forever.
So that brings up a few more things that I think are super interesting with what you do. When you talk about making them feel like part of the culture, part of that initially to me is like, well, now I have to be on calls with them all the time. Like I have to train them. They want to deal with me because I'm the guy who hired them. I'm the one from the company. How are you now managing the day-to-day or the week-to-week to make them feel like they're part of stuff? So you're plugged in and you're not leaving them alone on the island, but you're also not giving up all your time, which was the whole point of you hiring them.
Yeah. I mean, I tell everybody, you know, you should have a meeting with your VAs, you know, a couple of times a week on the low side in the beginning. Now let's say a lot of people want to meet with their team every morning. When you've got a virtual team, you know, a 10-minute meeting in the mornings mean a lot. Right. So if you do a 10-minute meeting in the mornings, doesn't mean you can't take a few days off here and there and not do that. But it's not that much effort to jump on Zoom for 10 minutes and meet your team, give them direction for the day and give them, make sure that there's no obstacles that they're having trouble with. So part of it is just meeting with them. I'm doing meetings. I'm now down to one meeting a week with my team. Yeah. We do one 30-minute meeting on Mondays. We're typically done in 20 to 22 minutes every meeting. But a lot of these VAs have been with me for a really long time. So, it just gets easier. So you put a lot of your heavy load in the beginning, you meet with them and you give them direction and that's really what they want. And then they want to feel part of the team and then you can back that down over time. No different than, you know, if you've got an American employee that has worked with you for a really long time, you don't necessarily have to hold their hand as much years down the road. So, that's the big thing. Just don't be afraid to be available and meet with the team and make sure that they don't have questions on stuff.
That's outstanding, man. And when you go through that, obviously, I assume you're able to keep those meetings shorter and sweeter because you have certain metrics that you're looking at to keep them accountable. Because I've heard you say it before, where like, man, I got busy doing stuff. And it's like, yeah, well, what does stuff mean? Like, and there's nothing to back that out. So when you have these actionable stuff, is that why you're able to do that? Are you basically having the KPIs so you know what you're getting into before you even get on the call?
Yeah, you should. Every single meeting should have an agenda, you know, and it doesn't just mean that doesn't just the case with VAs. Any meeting that you ever have scheduled should have an agenda of what you're planning on covering. You know, for us, we talk about, you know, what deals we talk. We always go through like, okay, what deals closed last week? What deals are closing this week? You know, what contracts are we expecting to get this week? We talk about KPIs as far as like individual KPIs, making sure that each individual VA was held accountable for the KPIs they're responsible for. And then we talk about, you know, where's the bottlenecks? Where's the problems? What are you struggling with right now that you wish we could overcome? And we attack bottlenecks and figure out how to overcome those as a group. And then that takes you to the next level.
That's such great information, man. I love all that. Now, hiring obviously is a big piece of it, but as you start to deal with VAs and full disclosure, a lot of the ones that I say, like, you know, I have to fire a lot of them, I look back and it's 100% my fault for not doing the things that you're talking about right there. But there is a certain level of turnover. So what are some tips to firing VAs as far as, do you have three strikes? Like, are there some deal killers? Like, what are some hard and fast rules of like, this is how you get caught or this is what that looks like? When is it time to cut the cord?
Yeah, you know, so here's the thing is you want to hire slow and fire fast. If you do a really good job of hiring, you won't have to do that much firing. But these are still human beings we're talking about, right? And so you're going to make a bad hire every once in a while, even if you do everything right on the front side. So typically what we do when we fire somebody is it's just numbers based. You know, hey, you know, here's your tasks. Here's what you're doing and not doing. And here's why we have to let you go. You know, yeah, you can do a three strike system. I think that's not a bad plan. Bottom line is this: if somebody has a written process or a video process that they're supposed to follow and they choose not to follow that, that is a strike, because that's just a simple decision. I'm not going to follow that process, or I'm not going to do my job. And so you have a conversation with them and you say, hey, you know, it's very simple. Here's what we hired you for. Here's what you're supposed to be doing. Here, you're not doing it, you know, strike one. So step one is if you don't have written processes or video processes of what that VA is supposed to be doing and how to do their job, then how can you blame them when they don't do it, right? So that if you leave a gap and there's confusion, trust me, they're going to get tripped up. And then you can't, it's really not their fault. I always use the analogy like this. Let's say you buy a brand new computer, an Apple computer, right? Best money can buy, $3,000, $4,000 computer. And you hand that computer off to a computer programmer who's not very good at writing code. And they take that brand new laptop and they write code and they mess up some algorithms and the math problems don't work and they hit go and it crashes. Where is the computer the problem or is the code the problem? The problem is that the computer's brand new. It's state of the art. It didn't mess up. The person writing the code messed up. Your VA is the computer. Your code is your processes. So step one, when a VA is messing up, first thing you need to do is go back to your processes and say, what did I miss? Why can't this VA accomplish this task? Why are they inconsistent? And try to see if you've got broken code. So that's how I usually deal with that. And then if you have a good system and processes, it eliminates most of the issues. Keep in mind, we're still dealing with human beings. There is tools that you can buy if you want to, quote unquote, micromanage your VAs. You can get things like Hubstaff that take screenshots of their screen throughout the day and manages. It's a time clock system and it manages, their productivity levels. So it's cheap. You can get that for $10 a month or whatever it is and help keep an eye on your VA. And we do that sometimes, but ultimately, if we do our job right and hire the right person, the right core values, we don't need to micromanage them. But it's not a bad tool because they are, 8,500 miles away.
Yeah. Now that's awesome stuff, man. So as far as creating systems and processes and stuff, obviously over time, things change, market shifts, processes shift, world shifts. So dispositions, I know you're doing a lot of now as well. And I think earlier you were saying like the majority of your deals now are wholesaling. So obviously there's acquisitions and there's the dispo side. I feel like that's part of what's shaped or reshaped even more in the last 6 to 12 months and some of the other strategies. So how have you evolved your business to be able to still disposition successfully?
Yeah, I'll answer the question in two parts. Part one is, as the market shifts and you change the tactics that you're using to do more deals or to start doing more deals or make more money, the easiest way to make sure that those tasks are being done is simply add them to your end of day report. We have VAs send a start of day report, which is just, hey, I'm clocking in for the day. It's just an email. They're saying, hey, I'm clocking in for the day. Here's what's on my agenda to do. And then at the end of the day, they do their end of day report and they say, here's what I got done. And if there's a specific task that you want to make sure is implemented, just add it to the end of day report. Start measuring the thing that you want to improve, and then it'll get done and you'll start seeing results from it. So that's like part one of that question. Part two is the market has changed a lot. In the last couple of years, probably 2021, we were wholesaling a lot to hedge funds. Hedge funds were buying, it was great because they paid top dollar for houses and they were buying a lot of them. And that went away. That when the interest rates started rising 18 months ago, the hedge funds started to scatter, and they're not even they're not buying from us at all right now, and haven't for a long time. So when that happened, you have two choices. Okay, you can sit around and cry about it and say, oh, the gravy train's over, or you can say, let's get to work and figure out where to find, who's the new buyers that are going to buy. Who has cash that wants to make a move. And so we just basically zeroed out our buyers list and rebuilt it from the ground up. And I mean, we're still wholesaling a ton of, we're probably wholesaling more now than we were even to the hedge funds, mainly because there's a lot of magic that happens when you kind of reboot. You get refocused and you find new things that work that maybe didn't work before. And in my case, I'm kind of the who, not how guy. I try to put talent. I hire the most talented people I can, and I put them on problems to go solve. And so on the dispo side, we just hired a really talented dispositions VA, and her job is to add buyers to the buyers list every single day. And when I say add buyers, like here's one thing I see a lot of people messing up. They pull a cash buyers list and then they send deals to that cash buyers list. That's a mistake, because you haven't contacted each one of those cash buyers to make sure that they want to actually see your deals. So we don't add a buyer to our list until they have responded, yes, I want to see your deals. Here's my email address. And so you got to add cash buyers the right way to your list. And then you've got to market to them. You've got to add value. You know, if a buyer has a bottleneck, you can help them overcome that bottleneck and they'll buy more houses from you. The dispositions VA, you know, here's the thing about dispo that I want everybody to understand. Dispositions is not sales. Acquisitions is sales. Dispositions is marketing. So, you know, I see a lot of people hiring salespeople for dispositions and then they struggle to get consistency. That's because it's a marketing job. You should be adding buyers to your list every single day, and you should be marketing to those lists, i.e. sending them deals, and then it becomes a follow-up. So it's really a follow-up game, getting deals in front of people and following up until they give you an answer, whether, hey, stop, you know, if they respond to an email, hey, I'm interested in this house, and then they kind of go quiet on you, you should be following up with them until they say, hey, yes, I'm sorry, life happened, I got busy, you know, I'm trying to run my whole real estate operations by myself, yeah, I want to go look at that house. Or they say, no, I'm just not interested. And then if they do say they're not interested, we always ask them what price would make it interesting. Sometimes they'll say no price because it's just too much work, or they'll give you a price. And then it's a renegotiation game if your buyers are not willing to pay the price that you have the property for. But that is a follow marketing and follow-up position. And when people start to realize that it's not sales and it's marketing and follow-up, you'll close more deals for sure.
That's gold right there, man. You just got me rethinking my whole thing. And you triggered another question now. So if dispositions is now sales and not follow-up, it triggers the probably evolving question, which I'm sure you're getting a lot now. You're the VA guy. Are you starting to transition out of or some sort of integration to be the AI guy?
Mm-hmm. So here's the thing. AI is kind of like the internet of, you know, 1995, right? Internet rolled out and a lot of people thought it was a really cool, you know, widget or cool little tool, but nobody really knew how to use it yet. And then there was a few people that really started to understand how to use it, and those people became billionaires. And so we're in that 1995 phase of AI. I think it's a powerful tool. I don't think anybody really realizes how powerful it is yet and all the possibilities it can be used for. The gap with AI is, and we do use AI in my company for sure, and I'm testing new things with it all the time. I've got a little side project I'm doing right now with some marketing with it. But the issue is somebody has to operate the AI. And so anytime I talk to, and I'm in talks with AI developers right now, and it's always funny because they'll show me something really crazy that it can do. And I'm like blown away. Like, I just can't believe that where this is heading. It's pretty exciting. But then I say, who's running it? And like, well, you need a VA for that. So, you know, can it make a VA's workload go a lot? You know, can they get more work done with it? 100%. But you still need the VA. So now that will change one day. Maybe in 2, 3 years, 5 years or something, there will be a platform that operates that you don't need the VA to kind of like get it started. And you know, pull a list and skip trace the list and upload the list and like, and all that stuff. And maybe that'll happen. I'm sure it will someday. Right now, that's not the case. So, yeah, I do pay attention to AI. I think it's a very powerful, it's going to change the industry by far. It's going to change a lot of industries, but it's still kind of a, it's so in its infancy yet. We don't really know how to really use it. Like it probably will be used soon.
Great insight, man. And I very much respect all your opinions on this because you're one of the few guys that's actually been around a long time where a lot of the people that are pushing stuff, they only started investing in the last few years. So they don't mm-hmm. know what it's like to adapt to different markets and see the evolution of things that maybe we call them a different name, but it's just the same kind of evolution of just life and business. So being that you're almost 20 years in the game now on such a high level, what do you see coming or changing, or what's your opinion of the landscape of real estate over the next 12 to 24 months?
You know, I really feel that we're going to see a pretty big downturn, and you know, nobody has a crystal ball, and you know, when we make predictions, you know, I'm definitely I don't bet 1,000 when I make predictions, but when you make predictions, it's just probability. It's right. It's like, hey, I might 80% chance this will happen, but my prediction is it's going to. Next year is an election year. They're going to lower interest rates. And they're already, I've been saying this for a while now, and now it's in the news that they're saying this is going to happen. But I've been saying they're going to lower interest rates next year for sure, because the people that are in office want to get reelected, right? And what, it doesn't matter whether you're a Democrat or Republican. If the Republicans were in office, they'd be doing the same thing. It's just smart, right? You know, like Bill Clinton said, it's the economy, stupid. You know, it's like, you want to be reelected. So you got to do what you got to do to make that happen. And everybody's, it's all about their pocketbooks. Like if people are making money, they're happy. If they're not, they're looking for a change. And so I see next year, I see it to rebound. But the problem is there's a hangover that'll happen when you hand out free money, right? Mm-hmm. And when you lower interest rates, which is basically like free money. It's going to be bad after that. And you can't stop. You can't manipulate forever. And so I think next year will be pretty, pretty good. I think if they lower interest rates, real estate's going to go to the moon, which is going to cause a domino effect and a major crash for 2025. Again, nobody has a crystal ball. That's my opinion. I think we're going to see a big opportunity to buy real estate really cheap in 2025, 26, 27. It'll be a repeat of the 08 market.
Oh man, excellent information, sir. So obviously if people are interested in learning more from your brain, from your experience, they want to talk to Deal Lab, Real Estate Matt mentorships on all shapes and sizes, rapid assistance. Talk about what you got going on, because I know you can help people in a lot of different ways.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I have a, if you go to my website, you can find all my social platforms. I'm most active on Facebook, by the way. But if you go to my website, realestatematt.com, that's realestatematt.com. If you go to there, all my social platforms on the first page, you can see my VA services through a couple of buttons on the page too. I mean, I'm always active on social media. I post every single day. And so I'm always trying to, and you know, I'm always sharing my ideas. You know, we've been around a while. We have ideas. Some of them are good, some of them bad, but I like to share what I'm thinking about. If anybody wants to contact me, if you message me, I'll message you back. I'm not one of those guys that will ignore you. We stay pretty active. I actually have some VAs that help me manage. We get a couple hundred messages a day right now, and they help send them in emails to me so I can get back to people. If it takes a day or so, that's okay. We'll get back to you and we'll answer your question.
That's awesome, man. So as far as, is this basically if somebody's looking for mentorship on the real estate side, there's like one branch that they can work with you with, and then the other side of people are looking to implement. How does the conversation start if they're looking for VAs?
Yeah, so I mean, I do have a weekly, I keep my stuff really cheap on the education side. I just don't overcharge. I've had people say my $47 a month Deal Lab is better than their $15,000 a year. They learn more in my $47 Deal Lab than they do in a $15,000 membership. And so I try to keep the education affordable for everybody, because I just feel that everybody needs it. So So we do have the Deal Lab. It's a weekly meeting that I do every Tuesday live. People can ask questions at the end. I pick a topic every week based on my own business and what I'm doing. So we do that. And if somebody wants to learn more about it, just send us a message. We'll help. We'll see if it's right for them. And on the VA side, virtual assistant side, again, send me a message on Facebook. It's the easiest way to get a hold of us. We'll get on a call with you and see if it's a good fit. I have people call me all the time and say, I just want all your VAs, give me the whole team. And we literally talk them out of it. Like, hey, maybe it's not right for you. If you've never done a deal, one VA might be a good step to get you some marketing, some leads. But if you've never done a deal, you can't manage a full team. You're just not ready for that. If you've done a lot of deals and you're not using VAs, it'll probably put your business on steroids and you'll do a lot more. So it just depends. Those are unique conversations that we like to have. We don't get on these calls to sell people. We get on to educate them and ourselves to see if it's a good fit for them.
Fantastic, man. So anybody listening, obviously I'll have links in the show notes for all your social media, all the different links directly to your website so you guys can start that conversation, follow you, watch you, see all the stuff you're working on. You are obviously somebody who brings your A-game to everything you do, and this interview has been no different. You definitely brought your A-game today for this podcast, sir. I really much appreciate it. Any final thoughts before we let you go about your day?
Yeah, you know, final thoughts. People always ask me, you know, where should I invest my money? Start out by investing in yourself. That's the best investment you can make. Put some money into your education and start there.
Wise words. So I really appreciate it. Again, this was long overdue and lived up to the expectation. I appreciate everything you're doing. I appreciate you being here. Matt Larson, ladies and gentlemen, have a fantastic day.
Thank you.